Thank you for letting us do this, Dr. Lon. It's really cool. So basically, we've been tasked with kind of reflecting on our journey here. And you heard Jake and Muhammad last week. Those guys were great. And we kind of just wanted to go through some of our reflections about what residency's been for us the last 7 years. And so I titled my talk, Ramblings of a Retiring Resident, but it is a little bit of a ramble, so bear with me. As we kind of see the light at the end of the tunnel, it's amazing how fast it's gone by. I think back about the journey to become a neurosurgeon, and I think of it kind of like a pipeline. And if you stay within the rails and you hit each milestone and you do each thing you need to do, you can get to the next step. But each one of those things takes so many hurdles to do. But it's unlike other jobs where you make lateral moves and you move up and you do this and you go back, and it's this straight line. And if you can go through each of those steps, you can get there. But it's a lot of work. And thing that I learned really early on while I was a student there is that mentorship is so important. Dr. Vates pushed really hard for me to be able to come to Barrow, and they really stuck their neck out for me, and I'm eternally grateful to them for that. So when I came out to Arizona, I came for Barrow. I had no idea what to really think. The only exposure I had to Phoenix was my grandparents, who had snowbird to Sun City West, so this is kind of what I thought Phoenix was going to be like. But it turned out to be a great city, and I've really loved living here for the last 7 years. When we came here at the beginning of our journey, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, this is orientation day on the left, and this is at intern boot camp in Portland on the right. We didn't know what we would see. We saw a lot of crazy things, and junior residency was a wild ride. It was time in the trenches. And this is after a fallen soldier, and a year and a half later, us, the three of us, and this is back before Barranco Bucks, so we had to bring our lunches. So, we went through a wild ride. These guys got me through some battle wounds. This is Jake and Alex picking me up from surgery because I didn't have any family here. But we took it in stride, and we gained another great guy, Muhammad, and what you realize is it's the terrible part of junior year is also the best part. And sometimes you just have to, what I call embracing the suck and grow to love the hard parts, because it's not what's happening to you. It's what happens inside of you during that time. Those years were really formative and they were really terrible. But because of the smiles of Jake, Alex, and Muhammad, I was able to make it through. One of the cool things about our class was that we were the last class to get to be Dr. Spetzler's third year rotations, and then we also got to be Dr. Lawton's chiefs. And I was his last rotating resident. For some reason, I take a lot of pride in that, but it was a really amazing experience. This is his last case on the right. I learned a lot from those 3 months. It was an incredible experience. But what you learn from Dr. Spetzler is that people want to be part of something bigger, and he made us all feel like everything that we did was a part of a bigger mission. And I know Dr. Lawton has done that too, and it's a really amazing thing. The other thing is, when you worked with Dr. Spetzler, he never micromanaged you, and he always let you go on your own, and he always had your back no matter what happened. And you learn from him that leaders become great not because of their power, but their ability to empower others. And everybody wanted to work their best when they worked for him. And we took more pride on that rotation than anything else in residency. And I know the other guys can testify to that. I got interested in spine fairly early on, largely because of these two guys. I always saw Dr. Sontag as this idyllic figure in academic neurosurgery and someone I wanted to follow in his path, and Dr. Theodore was an amazing mentor. After giving me some a hard time during my interview here, he told me something that stuck with me, and he said, there's two people that come to the Barrow. He said, there's the people that work really hard to get here, and They stay the status quo and they wind up great neurosurgeons. And he said, then there's the people who come here and use this as their launch pad to an amazing career, and they keep going. And you get to decide which of those two people you want to be. And that's something that's stuck with me forever. I kind of see myself in this position now, like the Roman god Janus, who is the god of doors, gates, and transitions, half with one foot in and half looking at my future. And I am trying to figure out, how am I going to keep that motivation going forward? How am I going to continue to have that same sort of trajectory that I came into residency with? And I thought about, what were the things that really motivated me through residency? Some of them were external. This was my desk. I don't know if you can read that, but it says get to work. Alex put this up in front of my desk, and it stayed there for about 2 years. And some of our motivation is through who we're with. And these guys have propelled me to do better every single day. All the residents here have. And one of the things you learn on your first day at the Barrow is there's no such thing as the best resident at the Barrow, because everybody is so incredible. And so I hope that I can find people like this as I move into the next stage of my life that continue to make me want to be a better person. Neurosurgery is very unique, and it's the coolest field, and we're so lucky to be able to do that. And I think you heard from Muhammad's talk, and you hear it from a lot of people's talk, it's not for granted that we get to be here. And you have to remember to be true to yourself and where you came from, and never settle for anything less than your best, but not for others, for you and for your patients. So as I make the next step towards my journey towards this megalith in LA at Cedars-Sinai, I have a lot of hurdles to overcome. I'm gonna need to learn how to teach residents, to build a practice, to be part of an academic organization, and to you know, survive in a big city like LA. But I feel really grateful for everything that I've learned here, from all the spectacular faculty, from all the spectacular residents, and I'm really excited to take on this next part of my life. Thanks.
This is me on the day I graduated med school. I look almost the same now. I think I still have the same baby face. I have a lot more gray hair. But otherwise, I feel like a completely different person. I feel like I've changed so much from this person, both in how I kind of look at the world and how I see my role in the world. And I guess I've been thinking a lot about that, how that happens here. I think probably the easiest way to think about it is just you're here a really long time. 7 years is a really long time. I think if you put it in terms of the Barrow, these are the people that were in charge when we got here. These are the people running the Barrow, and we outlasted all of them. These are the people that hired me. It can be a little disconcerting when all the people that hired you suddenly are gone. You can feel like your job security might be up in the air, but we made it to the finish line. It's been pretty amazing, and I think Corey really hit the nail on the head. I think we felt like a very scary thing at the time, but we've had this incredible experience where we got to learn from Dr. Spetzler and everybody else, and now we've had this incredible, incredible four-year run with Dr. Ponce and Dr. Lawton. So I think we really got the best of both worlds. My dad was an incredible dad growing up. He was always around. He made it to every soccer game, even though I know now he was an incredibly hardworking neurosurgeon. It's kind of funny. I remember growing up, all the way up through high school, I don't think he ever once talked about neurosurgery at the dinner table, which I think about now when I come home. It's all I do is complain about my job at the table. So I think he understood that when he was home, he just wanted to be a dad. So I think I was naive enough when I was in med school that I thought I was making this decision of my own volition. I was choosing to be a neurosurgeon kind of my own accord. But I see now, looking back, that I probably ended up on this path because I wanted to emulate what my parents had, which was really great. I was lucky enough, just like everybody else here, to be picked to come here to the Barrow. This is the three of us as interns learning from Dr. Forseth. I remember how you come in. You come in overconfident, overwhelmingly positive, excited to help people, overjoyed at the thought of being a doctor, and then you meet the current juniors and they kind of tell you how it is. I remember my first day here, literally my first day as an intern. was Dave Hsu, who I'm sure everybody remembers, a graduated resident. It was his last day on junior call. And we were all standing there, all the new interns, kind of quaking. And Dave Hsu finished his last consult, put the pager down on the table, walked over in front of everybody in the corner of the room and just mumbled to himself that they can't hurt you anymore. And that was really like my first introduction. And I think that's what happens is you just, during your junior year, it's tough because you have this loss of your humanity, your empathy, your connection to others, and it's gradual. But by the end, it just feels so stark. I know our juniors are probably feeling it. But like Corey said, what gets you through is camaraderie. It's kind of being in the trenches together. And I think I was incredibly lucky. All three of us four of us were all incredibly lucky that whole year, because I think we wouldn't have been able to get through without each other. Leaning on each other, commiserating, complaining about the attendings behind their backs, things like that. That's what gets you through. I'm going to talk a little bit more about these guys later, but we also had these three people who were chiefs when we were juniors and then went on to become attendings here. And I think it's so important to have role models who show you how to keep your humanity, maintain your integrity as you kind of transition from being a resident and having this relatively dark view of the world into actually helping people and having that and kind of regaining your humanity. We had two other residents that I think were equally inspiring and great about that. And every one of these people checked in on us all the time. They kind of took it on themselves to see us outside of the hospital and make sure we were kind of on the straight and narrow. Anyway, as Corey put it eloquently, someday you come out of the tunnel and then everybody's asking you, what are you going to do with the rest of your life? And Labib came out of the womb ready to clip aneurysms, and Corey and Jake showed up and they knew they wanted to do spine, and I had no idea what I wanted to do. One day during third year, I heard this talk from our wonderful epilepsy surgeon, Dr. Chris Smith, where he talked about these three stone-cold successful randomized controlled trials for epilepsy and how we had these incredible interventions for epilepsy and surgery was this wonderful option, and we just don't do it. And a little bit of this talk is going to be a plug for that, because we really don't talk about it that often. But essentially what he was talking about was how patients with medically refractory epilepsy are 15 times more likely to have good outcomes compared to medicines. And the more you think about that, the more you think, what else in medicine has that? And then the other thing he kind of talked about is we just don't do a lot of it. There's about 4,000 surgeries a year in America. And again, there's probably about, I think now, 200,000 people a year that meet that criteria. So again, I remember hearing this talk, and for the first time, some cogs were turning in my head, and I felt like I was getting pulled towards something. And then I got to see him do this incredible surgery, which everybody here knows he does. This is the subtemporal selective amygdala hippocampectomy, which Jake Godzik, still after 7 years, cannot say. Traditionally treating mesial temporal epilepsy, where epilepsy is coming from the amygdala and the hippocampus, you do this surgery on the left, where you take out the whole temporal lobe to get to those structures. And Dr. Smith comes under the temporal lobe like a thief in the night and takes them out and leaves this whole lateral cortex intact. And it's this incredibly beautiful surgery. And I remember watching that surgery and feeling something click. Eventually, as a resident here, you know, 6 years go by quickly and slowly, both at the same time. And you end up back here and you're ready to be a chief resident. I don't think I can say enough about Corey, Jake, and Muhammad and how important they've been for me. I think, again, as the least impressive of this group, it's nice to be near them because they kind of pull you up just by gravity and inertia alone. I've learned so much from Muhammad's passion and perseverance to Jake's dedication and curiosity and Corey's tenacity and confidence. I think we just got lucky. We hit the lottery with the four of us. Since I'm the last one, I knew I was going to be last. I thought I'd brag a little bit about our class, because I think we've had a really great run here. We're the first group in a while to go 4-for-4 and all go into academics, which I think we're all very proud of. I know you're proud of that, Dr. Lawden. We published 226 papers between the four of us. And I think, most importantly, I think we had this incredible camaraderie while we were here. These are Christmas cards we used to send out every year. We sent them out as interns. I can't believe that didn't get us fired at the time. But the one on the left is when there were just three of us before Muhammad came, spooning in the call room. And then the one on the right is after Labib showed up and we found our Ringo. He claims he's John Lennon, but that's up for debate. And it's just been a fun 7 years. Going to each other's weddings. That picture in the middle at the bottom is when the three of us decided we didn't want to be all in our separate offices upstairs. So we just decided to squat in one office down in the chief offices. Corey Walker cut my hair for an entire year and a half to save money when I made some financial decisions that we've since come back from. The one on the bottom left is after we all got our jobs and we went out to celebrate with our hats where we're going. I think it's a wild thing to be 10 feet away from the same people 4 to 5 hours a day for 7 straight years and all of a sudden be hundreds of miles apart. I think that's probably going to be the hardest thing about leaving this place. I know our group text thread is still going to be going off daily, probably more than it already does, but that's, I think, going to be absolutely the hardest part about leaving this place. One of the other things you gain when you come to the Barrow is a family of residents. I think there's absolutely no doubt in the world that this is 100% the greatest group of residents in the entire country. I think for a lot of reasons, not only is everybody whip smart, I think we get along great. I think there's a sense of camaraderie and teamwork. And it has been just an absolute pleasure this year to get to be the chiefs that take care of this class. I think it's only up and up from here. 7 years in the desert, that's not only it. When I showed up here, I was single and I had a mattress on the floor like a serial killer. At some point I got married, so that happened while I was here. This is my beautiful, intelligent, definitely my better half wife. Before we got married, Rami Almefti, who was also a chief early on when I was a junior, met Jaya and then came up to me, and he's a man of very few words, and he said, "You outkicked your coverage so far on this one. If you don't marry her by the end of the year, you're gonna lose her." So that's what happened. We got married. This is one picture from our wedding, and then this is another picture from our wedding. We had a traditional Indian wedding, which if you haven't been to one, you should go, but there are a lot of outfit changes. I had two beautiful daughters while I was here. I feel so lucky to be in a residency program that not only supports residents with children, but actively encourages you to have them at every event. They ask you, like, when are you going to have a kid? Like, when are you going to do it? My two girls were born in this hospital, about 200 feet from where I'm talking right now. The big one is Ava and the little one is Davey, and they've been an absolutely luminescent addition to my world, and I just feel so lucky that, again, we're in a residency program that supports this kind of stuff. So now that I'm kind of at the end, I'm again thinking about that scale and how things tip over time. I feel like you're never going to change everything. I mean, you can't go back and regain all of those things you were before. But I just feel like when I'm leaving this place, I'm so lucky because I'm leaving with so many extra things in my backpack. You gain a passion, you gain a purpose, you gain skills and the confidence to use them. And I think you really gain a family inside and outside of the hospital if you do it right. So Dr. Lawton said, "Do you have any words of wisdom?" I feel like everybody in this room probably hears my words of wisdom every single day, so I apologize for that. But I guess a couple of things. We've had all these really great Grand Round speakers, like these world-famous Grand Round speakers this year. And it's interesting because a lot of them were near the end of their careers or retired. And everybody in that category, when they were asked what they were most proud of, I don't remember any of them talking about jobs they had or papers they published or awards they won. I think every single one of them was talking about the people they had trained, the people they had touched. I think that's an important thing to remember, that ultimately that's the thing that lasts forever is mentorship. And I think that my whole talk is just a series of people helping me along the way. So I hope everybody remembers that. I think the little things can go the longest way. Residents come and go every year. It's a revolving door. But I guess for the attendings, I think you can see in my talk, it's those little conversations, those little moments where you check in, the little things that really don't hurt you at all, where you're helping. Again, I think back to Dr. Sinai calling all the time to Cleveland Clinic until I get in. Those things can mean everything to a resident and can really go the longest way. And I think ultimately we just have the greatest residents in the world here. In particular, the group that's still here. I hope nobody ever forgets that. I think I just feel so lucky to have been part of it. So that's it. Thanks.